Begun recording now, and let me just say again, thank you to Dr. Melinda Trujillo for being here for How to Be an Ally, one of our first programs in anti-racism and allyship this year. I'll turn it over to you.
Hi, my name is Dr. Melinda Trujillo, and I am a psychologist here in Vancouver, Washington. I have a private practice, and I also work at the VA on the Vancouver side of the river. And my specializations include multicultural counseling, trauma, and diversity and inclusion. I actually have helped develop the race-based stress and trauma program for the entire VA system. And so this is near and dear to my heart. And what I, before I bring the slides up, what I just want to say is this can be a really hard topic to talk about. It's very near and dear to my heart. And what I want to see is, even though I do this work, I do not think I am immune to bias. I don't think, even though I was a psychologist, I was trained supposedly that we can be objective. I don't check myself at the door. And so with this presentation, I try to be vulnerable and be real and put myself out there as a way to model some of what this work takes, and also to be honest. And just from a personal level as to why this is important to me, I am biracial. I am Latinx, Mexican American, and European American. I am also white passing, which means, you know, in therapy language, my stimulus value, which is the way the world sees me, is people assume that I am white. And because that, I feel like I actually have a double obligation to do something different, because I do have white privilege, which means I can walk through the streets every day, unlike some of my family members, unlike my best friend with a similar background, who's a visible minority, and I can trust that probably people aren't going to attack me, and that if I get pulled over by a police officer, that I most likely will come out unharmed and potentially without even a fine or anything happening to me. And that is not the same for other Black, Indigenous, and other people of color. And with that, if you see the word BIPOC in my presentation, that is a long acronym for Black, Indigenous, and other people of color. Another thing I want to put out there is I'm going to be using words like white, and I'm going to use words like people on the upside of power or majority culture, because I don't think you can talk about allyship and racism and a lot of what we're talking about without acknowledging that some of us, depending on our identities, are on the upside of power. I shared with you, I have white privilege, and I'm white passing, so the world sees me that way. And I get treated very differently than people in my family that look different from me. And I'm just owning that. And so I'm just going to throw that out there, because some people do ask why we might focus. Some of my presentation will be focused on white allyship specifically. And the reason for that is we can all be biased, but not everyone can hide their marginalized identities. So with that, I'm going to share my screen and I'm going to start the presentation. Thank you all for coming. So our learning objectives today are to define systemic racism and race-based trauma, define white privilege and white supremacy, and identify skills and resources for becoming an ally, and identify resources for engaging in anti-racism. So what I want to talk about is, what is structural racism? Basically, what structural racism is a normalization and legitimization of an array of dynamics that routinely advantage white folks, and they produce a cumulative and chronic adverse outcome for people of color. They're designed to reproduce disparities and reinforce itself. It functions largely on implicit bias, and I'm going to define what implicit bias is in just a minute. And it's reflected in history, culture, and it's interconnected. It manifests in all areas of life: housing, education, media, wealth, jobs, criminal justice, and healthcare. And if you are not on the downside of power, it's really hard to see that systemic racism exists. For example, as a white person, makeup was designed for me. I'm a therapist. Psychotherapist predominantly was designed by white folks for white people and studying on white people. The way our medication, our money, our history, although we are a very multi-ethnic country and always have been, the history we learn growing up in school is the history of European Americans. Until we become aware of this, it's like swimming in the water. You don't know that the water's blue until you start to look at the system. But I'll tell you, although I am a white passing biracial person, I've always been aware because I grew up in a multi-ethnic family where I saw some of the brutal violence that we've heard about more recently with the deaths of Breonna Taylor and George Floyd and so many other men and women of color. And so I want to talk a little bit about where do we see systemic racism? I just want to give you some facts, the wealth gap. Back in the 2010 census, Black Americans made up 13% of the country, but only had 2% of its wealth. The median net worth for a white family, was $134,000, and for a Latino family was $14,000, and for a Black family was $11,000. And if you add other intersectionality, women and women of color, it's half that. So just think about that. Think about maybe how much the mean income is for you or your family, and think about it, what that means for people of color. Employment, Black employment is consistently twice that. The Black unemployment rate is specifically that, twice that of whites. Another example, and this has been repeated since this original study across different ethnic sounding names. Basically, they do studies where they send out really good resumes to large companies. And one of them, they have a Black sounding name like Jamal, and another, they might have a white sounding name like James. And just by having a white sounding name, those resumes are 50% more likely to get callbacks for interviews. And this has been repeated throughout the United States and internationally. There's many other examples I can provide, but I just want to give you a few examples. Housing discrimination, colonialism, legalized segregation, and there's something called redlining. Basically, literally laws and zones are created still in real estate that do not allow people of color to get equitable loans or even buy houses in certain areas. And unless you are a person of color, you may not see it. For example, I have a friend who's a very well-educated, middle-class Black woman. And she said when she went in for a housing loan on her own, she couldn't get one. She brought her white husband with her, was not a problem. And so it's just everywhere. Another thing that I want to point out is that people of color are more likely to live in what's called a food, health, and educational desert. That means there aren't hospitals that are local. The food that is available might be from like a 7-Eleven or a convenience store. And it's also an educational desert. We do not have an equal educational system because our educational system is often by tax bracket. And if you think going back to what I said about the disparities in wealth between people of color and whites, where you live determines the way you can move up socially and even access to just basic things like education, food, and basic healthcare. We've all seen this with COVID-19. It has been decimating communities of color and hospitals like in Chicago and New York because they just don't have the services in a normal time to treat people at the level that they're getting sick. And now with how COVID has overwhelmed our healthcare system, it is devastating to everyone, but in particular to communities of color. Another thing that I want to talk about is incarceration. Out of every 100,000 Americans, about 700 are incarcerated, but out of every 100,000 Black men, over 4,000 are incarcerated. There's something called the school to prison pipeline. If you remember from the 90s, they started the three strikes, you're out law. And basically they started having school police officers in junior highs and high schools, and they are way more likely to target children of color. And so some of these kids are getting their first infractions in junior high and high school. And by the time they've even left high school, they have done away with some of those three strikes or outlaws, but basically they're already in that pipeline under prison. And oftentimes if it is a Black, a Latino, or another child of color, they're more likely to get 2 to 3 or 4 times more likely the punishment than their white counterparts. Immigration, I just want you to think about immigration. I mean, I know we've all seen the horrific ways that Latinx and other immigrants have been treated right at our borders, literally being put in a cage on our borders. And we think that's not happening. It's still happening. It's just not in our viewpoint. And literally the US immigration system as it exists now was designed to favor whites, people coming from Europe and other countries where people are predominantly white. There's been many exclusionary laws passed, the way they portray immigrants as criminals or if they're from a non-European country. And with that, if you don't have citizenship or if you don't have access to a green card, you're not allowed to vote. You're not allowed to get healthcare. You're not, you know, there's just so many things that it limits you. And that's literally with our immigration system. There's so many other things I could talk about. Another thing I want to talk about is health disparities. I touched on that with COVID, but basically racial minorities have higher rates of chronic illness, infant mortality, and also mortality in childbirth, early mortality, and health conditions which limits one's quality of life. For example, cancer, heart disease, COPD, asthma, the rates among people of color are 2 to 3 times higher. And I would say that's because of systemic racism. If you're living in a place where you cannot get healthy food, you cannot get access to healthcare, you cannot get access to equal education to help move up, you know, the social status to get access to those, that's going to impact your whole life. And later on, I'm going to talk about if every day you are facing racism in your life from the day you were born, what that does on the physical body and mind, and how that also leads to chronic conditions. Some of you may be familiar with these terms, but I want to put, they're often used in talks like this, and so I'm going to throw them out there. So unconscious bias, that means attitudes, stereotypes, or beliefs that impact your understanding and decisions in an unconscious manner. These beliefs can be positive or negative, and they're often activated involuntarily without our individual awareness or attention. So they're biases that you have. It could be positive or negative. For example, I'm Latinx. I want to tell you a positive bias I have. Oftentimes I help select our students for the hospital program for our training. And I have an affinity bias, which means when I see a Latinx student apply, I know that I already probably see them in a favorable light, and I kind of have to watch that. Like, we often think of our negative biases. Another thing to know about is that our unconscious biases, the biases we're not aware of having, will actually go against what we consciously think we are, you know, espoused to. For example, if you want to check out what types of unconscious biases you may have, there's something called Project Implicit, where you can learn about, you can actually take tests about your unconscious bias. My father was a man of color. I grew up in a multi-ethnic neighborhood. I consciously don't think I have bias about men of color being more likely to be criminal, but I took one of the online tests not that long ago, and it showed that I had a moderate negative bias about potentially viewing men of color as violent or engaging in violent crime. I don't consciously hold that belief, but we know that's a societal belief. And so we are not immune to the society that exists around us. Another thing is explicit bias. This might be what you think of as bigotry or outright racism. These are the attitudes, stereotypes, or beliefs that you consciously are aware that you have. They're both dangerous, but sometimes people say what's more dangerous is the unconscious part. If you don't know that you have them, then they can interact so many levels of your life. And if a system doesn't know they have them, that's even worse. And that's why I really think you cannot talk about racism without talking about systemic racism. So I want to talk about race-based stress and trauma. A lot of people think, when we think of racial trauma, people may think of like the death of George Floyd or any of us that came up in the 90s, the beating of Rodney King. Of course, those are horrific events that we cannot minimize. And those are a form of race-based trauma, but there are also other forms of trauma that minorities experience. Every day they are treated differently than other folks, they're denied access, or there's things said about them, and that happens on an everyday part of their life. And it's not something that is easily understand if you are a white person or you have white privilege like me. I'm white passing because I don't get treated that way. And some people kind of blow off these things like, oh, you're making out a mountain out of a molehill. But can you imagine if every day somebody said a comment about who you are, how you act, denied you access to care, treated you differently, saw you as a criminal, that has a cumulative effect. A very famous psychiatrist that I very much respect said it's death by 1,000 cuts. And so what I want to talk a little bit about are different ways race-based trauma can impact people of color. If you live in constant fear of race-based trauma happening to your loved ones, that takes an effect. If you're constantly being treated differently, denied access, marginalized, judged, that can lead to hypervigilance, being afraid of your environment, depression, an intrusion, the inability to get the thought out of what happened out of your head, apathy and numbing and questioning your sanity. I mean, literally think about it. I actually had somebody that I know that it was, you know, was trying to talk about their experience of being a Black person in this country. And when George Floyd's death and so many deaths before it were on loop everywhere on social media, people were making memes about it. And I heard white folks say, we need to see this. We need to be aware of it. But I sat there thinking, what do they realize what it must be like to be a person of color and literally see someone murdered that looks like them on national TV? And even if they want to turn it off, it's everywhere. And this is not the first and it's not the last. And I don't think people, I do think we should be aware, but I think we also should be aware about the viralization of Black and Brown death and how that must impact people. Other types of race-based trauma are racial harassment, discrimination, witnessing violence, institutional racism. Examples of this, I don't know if you guys have heard of the Tuskegee studies. They basically did horrific testing on Black and Brown folks that was sanctioned by the US government. I work within mental health. Still to this day, Black and Brown folks are more likely to be diagnosed with a psychotic disorder, more likely to be put on very intense psychotropic meds. If they're in a hospital system or if they're in a psychiatric unit, they're more likely to be placed in restraints. And there's so many ways that it goes on and on and on. Also overt and covert racism. The reason I bring up unconscious bias is it might even come from well-intentioned people. I lead our race-based stress and trauma group. I don't know how many Black men and women and other women of color that have been in my group and have told me how people go and pet them like an animal and ask to touch their hair or ask them where do they come from, or talk about them like they're a rug, you're exotic, you know. And we might think we're, you know, or, oh, you have such a nice shade of skin, you know, but I don't think people think about how talking about people that way objectifies them. So literally you're invading their personal space, but you're also telling them you're not a person, you're an object. The way we sometimes think we're, you know, admiring a person of color is actually dehumanizing them. We talked about microaggressions and unconscious bias. These can be direct or indirect slights, both in an environment as well. And I'll give you another example. When I first worked at the VA, we had a hard time keeping women and people of color and young veterans. And that was because in the program that I was helping with, pretty much we had mostly served white Vietnam veterans for many years, which makes a lot of sense. But we didn't offer any materials for women. We didn't offer any groups for women or men of color. We didn't do anything for our younger vets. So of course we didn't keep them. So that's basically a systemic bias or systemic microaggression where the system around you, but we're serving vets. And for so long we had served white male Vietnam veterans that we had created a program by them and for them. And I of course think we should still honor our Vietnam era veterans. And of course I think we should still honor white veterans and anyone that served. But if you create an environment that doesn't reflect the people that are being seen there, you're not going to continue to see them. And so some of the changes we made is we created, we actually had women's bathrooms. We created material for women veterans and young veterans. We created groups for veterans of color. And, you know, there's, you know, they say, if you build it, they will come. And that's pretty much what happened because we actually changed the system. But for so long, we created a system to serve a veteran of a certain era, of a certain time and of a certain ethnicity that folks weren't even aware that the environment wasn't very welcoming. I did talk already about the death of Black, Indigenous, and other people of color going viral. Another thing that I want to be aware of is that even before this went viral, even before social media, if you grew up as a person of color it was always viral before viral was a thing. My father, I can tell you personally, was beaten nearly to death because he was walking out of a bar with my mom, and apparently a Latinx person had committed a crime. And so without even asking, they picked him up, they beat him, and they put him in jail. And I can tell you personally, I know several of my family members who had very similar stories, and all they were doing was being a man of color or a woman of color doing normal things. And so this is not new. It may be new for some folks, but it's not new for the people who live it and breathe it every day. Other aspects of race-based trauma is it can impact you physically. You can have sleep problems. I mean, literally, we think about flashbacks, meaning something traumatic coming back to you in your dreams or daily. Think about if you are a person of color who's experienced racism or has experienced ethnoviolence, and it's everywhere on the news. Low energy and fatigue, memory and concentration problems. If you have to spend so much of your time filtering out negative messages, being rejected, there's also something called code switching for people of color in order to sometimes survive living in a primarily white environment. They will maybe change the way they dress, the way they talk, the way they act, because when they are authentically themselves, they get criticism. You talk too much. You're too loud. You're too emotional. You're too this, you're too that. The whole world is always telling them how they should be. And it's pretty much telling them you should be white. And so that's exhausting. It takes up a lot of mental energy. And if your body's constantly in hypervigilance, constantly aroused, it can lead to poor health outcomes, physical injury, and the health disparities that I talked about earlier. And also, just like I talked about, another disparity is that they just don't have equal access to education, insurance, hospitals, immunizations, and so on and so on and so on. And so it doesn't surprise me. I want to talk about the behavioral impact of race-based stress and trauma. What it can lead to is when you are told over and over again, not only are that what you do and who you are is wrong, but you're literally not even human by the way people treat you, you can start to internalize that. It's called internalized depression or acculturated. And so what it can lead to is not taking care of yourself, or it can lead to depression and post-traumatic stress. And one of the symptoms is disconnection from friends and disconnecting from the self. And sometimes to numb the pain of what it's sometimes like to be a person of color in this world, people do go to alcohol or drugs as a way of numbing the physical pain and the emotional pain they experience. Withdrawing, isolating, avoiding. I mean, can you imagine if every day you were told you're not human, and even if you are, who you are is wrong, you don't fit, this world's not for you. I don't think I'd want to leave my house. Disengagement from value-driven things. So things that, you know, if you're doing, one of my favorite, as a Latinx person, one of my favorite movies is Selena. She was a very famous Latinx singer that was killed in the mid-90s. And there's a scene in the movie where Edward James Olmos, who's a famous Chicano actor, he says, we've got to be more Mexican than the Mexicans and more whites than the whites, because there's this saying among people of color that we have to do 50% to 100% more than a white person to be treated the same way. And that is exhausting. And that can lead, there's also something called stereotype threat, and this has been proven again and again and again since the 60s. It's by a very famous Black psychologist named Claude Steele. Basically, just by implying that a Black person or a Latinx person or another person of color, one of the stereotypes is we're uneducated, we don't care about education, we're not smart, they compare us to animals, that's in the water and the air we breathe. And so they, even on tests they perform well, they will underperform, especially if any of those conscious or unconscious biases are implied. And literally you have the world telling people of color that they're unintelligent or they're not as good or they don't fit. We talked about living in a food and a housing and an educational desert. If you don't have the same access to these things, it is much harder to move up. I mean, we have this American myth, I actually grew up in Utah, and my European American side was Mormon, they were pioneers, and there was this idea of like being a bootstrapper. If you just worked hard enough and long enough, you could be the same. But what I think people don't understand is, even if, you know, you have maybe even are lucky enough to be a person of color with access to all of these things, oftentimes they are not promoted in organizations. They are not represented in management. They're not valued. And so it, you know, it's, some people hear the glass ceiling with women. This is like a ceiling that is made out of a rock for a person of color. And so there is not equity in our country. It is a myth. Also increased exposure to risk factors, police brutality, violence, continued exposure to, basically they show for, when they've literally done at the cellular level and the brain level and the blood level, studying people of color who've been exposed to chronic stress of racism, they look like someone who survived a war zone. That's just one, something I want you to keep in mind. Their brains and their bodies look like someone who's survived a war zone. If you're constantly told you're not valuable, that might impact your interpersonal relationships, your ability to see that you deserve a good partner or that you deserve supportive friends. And what it leads to is dehumanization, marginalization, and disenfranchisement. I do this work, and what I often say to my clients is that taking care of yourself is a form of rehumanization of the self. That literally, that a lot of people get mad at the Black Lives Matter motto, you know, like why, well, all lives matter. Yes, all lives matter. But literally what Black and Brown people are told every day of their lives is that not only do you not matter, you are not human. And your only purpose is to serve a function for this country that doesn't accept you, doesn't love you, doesn't treat you right, and doesn't give you access to the same things that we proclaim in our country to be all about: life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And so, you know, when Black Lives Matter movement started, the reason they said Black Lives Matter, it's not because other people don't matter, because they were literally saying, I'm a human and I matter. And just by starting that, starting to see people as human, that can change this system, you know. And we've all heard about George Floyd's death. Literally what finally outraged our country after 43 deaths, very similarly happening in the last 5 years, is that people saw a white officer standing on the neck of an unarmed man for 8.5 minutes with his hands in his pockets and doing nothing and watching him die as he begged for his mother. And he literally must not have seen him as human, because I don't think I could do that. And that's when our country finally started to look, after over 400 years of Black and Brown death and marginalization and perpetration. And so some of the things I want to talk about is, what are white privilege? What is white supremacy? So white privilege is the unearned advantages, access, and systemic favoritism that white people receive from individuals, organizations, systems, and society simply because they are white. I mean, there's many examples. If you want to learn about white privilege, Amy's going to send out, I have a very small list of resources that can kind of expand what I'm talking about in this presentation. Also, as one of my favorite colleagues said, just go to the Church of Google. Because of what's happened right recently and throughout time, right now, if you want to learn about anything related to these topics, you literally just have to put the word into Google and you will find 15 amazing curated lists about how to learn about white privilege or white supremacy. But to give you an example, I am Latinx and white. My best friend is also Latinx and white, but she, to the world, she appears what people stereotype of a Latinx person. She has brown skin. We have very similar upbringings. We went into a mall together when we were in our 20s, and I went to college with her, and she said, wow, this is the first time I've walked into the mall and people have offered me samples or offered me free perfume or talked to me. And I'm like, what? And I, you know, and even though I grew up in a community of color, in a family of color, I was white. And I was very aware of my whiteness in many ways, but it didn't even occur to me, you know, that she said, yeah, when I usually walk into this mall, even though I grew up in this small town, I get followed by police officers. I don't get offered anything to buy. Nobody talks to me. I get asked why I'm here. That's just a small example that I became aware of. But there's so many ways that white privilege comes up, you know, and because in a nutshell, what white privilege is this country, this world, was colonialized by white people. So we are taught white history. The things that we call American or cultural values are considered from European and American, white American history. Band-aids, hair products, food, everything that is predominantly tested on white people. And so you may not be aware of this, but literally this world was created for you. I'm not saying if you have another marginalized identity, say you identify as LGBTQIA+, say you grew up in poverty, those things matter. So it doesn't mean you haven't experienced being other, but it still is different if you are a person of color. Another thing is white supremacy. White supremacy is the belief that white people and white culture are superior to all their races. And because of this supremacy, white people should have and hold access to wealth, power, privilege, and dominate other racial groups. White supremacy is historical, ongoing, and systemic. I know coming up, I was always taught to think of white supremacy as, you know, like neo-Nazi movement. Of course, that is a stem of it. But white supremacy is also exactly what I told you. We were, all of us who have white privilege or identify as white, we grew up with a history and a culture that was designed consciously and unconsciously to teach us that we are better. And so you can engage in white supremacy without having to be a neo-Nazi. If you wanna look into this, actually just put into Google white supremacy culture, and there's an amazing document out there. But that it's hard for people to think that way, because most of us think of a racist as an outright bigot, someone who's gonna call you a name, maybe beat you up. People think of a white supremacist as somebody who, like a neo-Nazi or a skinhead or someone from the alt-right who's gonna, engage in direct ethno-violence and threats. And of course, those are people who engage in white supremacy, but you can engage in using your privilege in a way that perpetuates the system, or engaging in white supremacy culture without knowing it, because it's so ingrained in our society. So I just wanted to dispel some myths. One of these myths is, I hear people say all the time, well, I'm not biased because I've been working on this. I've literally been doing diversity and inclusion training for 20 years now, and I do not think I have bias. And I am a psychologist. I study the human brain. And what we all know is our brain puts things into categories. We learn that a dog is a dog and a cat is a cat. And, this group is like this. And so because our brains are taught to think and judge and feel and categorize, we all have bias. So none of us is immune. The dangerous thing about bias is the unconscious part. One of my favorite quotes is an equal opportunity virus. And so much time I think it's wasted when we do allyship and diversity, when we like try to prove that we're not biased or prove that we're not racist or prove that we're not some kind of ist. But we all do this, But the thing is, because our brains judge and feel and learn, they have the ability to change. Another word I hate is, that's a strong word, cultural competence. There's kind of this idea that if you become an ally or if you do diversity training, it's like you get a certificate, like you're done. We are never truly cultural competent when it comes to diversity, inclusion, equity, anti-racism, and allyship, because they're ongoing skill sets. The other thing is racism has not ended, And it's because racism hasn't ended in other forms of ism, we still need to keep growing and learning and expanding our skill set. So I want to talk about privilege. There's a lot of different models of privilege, but I really like something called the COIN model of privilege. The COIN model of privilege says there are norms, patterns, and behaviors and systems that privilege some social groups over others, such as sexism, heterosexism, racism, ableism, and classism. These social structures create inequities in health, housing, vocation, and education, and individuals on the upside of power and the downside of power are interconnected. We often think about these as dichotomous, like you're either privileged or not privileged, you're either oppressed or you have power, but there's so many parts of our identities that depending on context can be impacted, and so I'm gonna show you an example. In this COIN model, if you look at the upper side, these are common privileges where if you have some of these, you are typically on the upside of power. So if you're upper middle class, if you're white, if you're a settler, what that means is if the group you come from colonialized another group. So let's think about the United States. We talk about this country belonged to Native Americans before whites ever came. And so if the country you live in engaged in colonialism and the ethnic groups that you belong to were part of that, there is a history that is still present. You know, even the way we talk about the United States, manifest destiny, that God gave white people the right to kill and rape and murder thousands and thousands and millions of Native Americans in the name of God to create this country. And that when we learn about the United States, we rarely learn about people of color. And typically we only learn about the Trail of Tears or slavery, basically how they were horrifically treated by white people. We don't often get to learn about strong people of color. Maybe we learn about Martin Luther King. Maybe we learn about Cesar Chavez. But mostly what we learn about is the most horrific parts of our country, even though Black and Brown and Indigenous people have been here since the beginning and have very much contributed to our country. So typically, if you are a person of color coming up in our educational system, you're not only are you taught that the only thing you should learn about yourself is the most horrific part of your history, either that or you're invisible. Being able-bodied, being straight, on flip side, not being male or female, being non-binary, being trans, LGBTQIA+, disabled, indigenous, and I'll give you a couple examples. So, you know, as someone who's white passing, the world sees me as white. So in some contexts, you know, I can deny my intersectionality. I can deny my marginalized identities. But on the flip side, that also is a lot very painful for me because sometimes people will say and do things in front of me that they would never say to me if they actually took time to learn about me or knew my identities. However, in different contexts, you know, if I'm working with a group of people of color and I am the person with white privilege, I'm on the upside of power. I might have shared some of their similar history or experiences, but by the nature of being who I am, then I'm on the upside of power. And so basically, this can kind of, we're all interconnected. And the other thing too, is a lot of folks who have majority culture or privileged identities or on the upside of power said, well, I'm not a racist. I wasn't a colonialist. Yes, but you still benefit from that. And you're still interconnected. And so until both people on the upside of power and downside of power interconnect and acknowledge that the system that maintains this power structure is systemic racism and inequality and oppression, it will actually stay the way it is. In fact, they've done a study because a lot of people think, oh, if we just, it's all about classism. If we just made everybody, if everybody had the same amount of money and access, then racism would end or sexism would end or any ism would end. But they actually have shown if everybody like became on the same financial footing and had the same access to education, if we didn't fix systemic racism and systemic oppression, with 100 years, the disparities that exist between whites and other people of color and marginalized identities would come back. So what is allyship? Allyship is an individual or group on the upside of power who actively allies with, advocates for, an individual on the downside of power. Allyship is a process and everyone has more to learn. Allyship involves a lot of listening, sometimes people say doing ally work or acting in solidarity with, or they reference the fact that ally is not an identity, it's an ongoing lifelong process. We can't stop. Like I said, racism hasn't stopped. Allyship can't stop. So I want to talk about some key, there are so many different aspects of allyship and anti-racism, but I want to highlight some things before we get to the question and answer part of this forum that I think are important. The first thing is education and ownership. And I'm not going to go into specifics like what books you should read because I literally said all you have to do is put it in Google, anti-racism, allyship, and there's a chain of things. I have highlighted some that Amy's going to send out, but ask yourself, how have I been a part of the problem? How have I benefited from systemic racism? I've been asking myself that, you know, as a white passing person, how have I contributed? Even with the work that I do, how have I benefited? Where have I turned a blind eye? This is the other thing I want to point out. If you did not see racism and systemic oppression, it's because you chose not to look, and that's a privilege and that's a problem. I've had so many people say, I just didn't know. I mean, literally, especially with the advent of social media in the last 20 years, there's no way you couldn't know. If you didn't know, it's because you didn't look. And so if you're here, that's good. It's good. You're choosing to look. And that's a step in the right direction. But you've got to realize the pain it is if you go to a person of color and say, I just didn't know, and what that must feel like. So that's something to think about. Another thing I want to say is, you know, I'm a psychologist. And so I've literally sat in meetings with my peers, and we're trained to help people that will say things like, well, if it matters to a client or a coworker, they'll bring it up. Well, I want to say not necessarily. And so even if you haven't actively, overtly engaged in racism or oppression, as far as you're aware of, realize that apathy and silence are interpreted as acceptance to both perpetrators and to victims. And also, if you did see it, but you didn't speak up, realize how much more of a risk and how much more painful it is for a person of color. They can lose their job. They can be ostracized. It could lead to violence. And how much more power you have in your silence or in your speaking if you are from a non-marginalized identity. Another thing is, take active steps to learn about systems of inequality for which you are a position of privilege. So if you've never really learned what it means to be a white person, then maybe you need to engage in some white literacy. Dr. Robin DiAngelo wrote a great book called White Fragility. I would highly recommend it. There's a lot of resources. I put one on there called White Allyship 101 that we're gonna send out, where you can learn, like, what is whiteness? Like, I don't even know what that means, because literally I don't know how many people that are European American that literally say, I don't have a culture. Well, you do, and it's not necessarily a bad thing. But if you do, and white privilege does exist. There's nothing wrong with learning from the expertise and working in solidarity with historically marginalized groups, but don't do it at the expense of their well-being. You know, one thing I keep telling people is, before you go to your Black friend or your colleague of color or your neighbor and say, wow, help me learn about racism, maybe you should ask if they're even interested or it's even in their bandwidth, you know. It shouldn't fall on the people who are being marginalized to fix it or to teach you. I'm not saying that people of color aren't willing to have those conversations, but you first might want to just ask if they're interested, if it's in their bandwidth. I mean, think about it right now with COVID-19 and the deaths of George Floyd and Breonna Taylor and so many other Black men and women, other people of color, what it must like be like just to get up every day, and then you might have your white neighbors or your white friends or your other majority culture peers asking you to have these conversations or educate them, you know. And so a kind thing is just to say, hey, I'm doing this work. I don't know if you're interested in talking to me about it or not. Is it in your bandwidth? You know, to really reach out in a way that's compassionate and kind. The other thing to do is to learn from your experiential reality. And what that means is, if you look around your life and everyone you are friends with or work with or have interaction with looks like you or acts like you, so if you're white and everyone's white, if you're Christian and everyone you know is Christian, if you're able-bodied and everybody you know is able-bodied, then that's not necessarily a problem, but that means that you really aren't having everyday contact and getting to know people who are different from you. And that means your worldview is pretty much confirmed by people who are like you. But I'm not telling you to engage in tokenism. And tokenism means, like, don't go seek out people of color or people from other marginalized identities just to, like, prove you're not racist or to prove, like, I would say let it happen naturally. So maybe join a book group, join a church, seek out natural places where you might end up befriending people based on the context. Just expanding your circle. Skills for allyship and racism: decenter yourself and watch up how much space you take. I'll tell you, I teach these trainings a lot, and even in a group of people of color, typically the first person to speak up and have an opinion is a white person. I'll tell you, I've had to watch that. I grew up in a very opinionated family. I was raised by a librarian. I'm a psychologist. I'm educated. And I find myself that I talk a lot and I take up a lot of space. And so I've been more and more aware of that and really watching that. And so, you know, if you're working in solidarity with a person of color or a group of color, don't be the first one to speak. Do a lot more listening. Another thing is, don't try to be a savior. Instead, act in solidarity. And what I mean by that is, oftentimes when a white person or a majority culture person or a person on the upside of power goes to work with a marginalized group, they want to start making the agenda. They want to start throwing out ideas before they even listen to the voices that they're trying to help and ask for what they want to do. Like with grassroots work, the first thing you do is what's called a focus group, which means you just bring a group of the group you're trying to ally with or work with and actually ask them, what is the problem? What do you think are the solutions? How can we help? But that's often not the way white folks and other majority culture of folks approach doing anti-racism and allyship. They typically talk a lot and have this agenda and have their ideas and oftentimes tell people of color or other marginalized groups what they should do. Another thing that I think it's, I have to tell you is like, you don't need to prove that you're not an ist, racist, sexist, homophobic, that you don't have bias, because this is actually a waste of time and not helpful to people of color or other groups, because it's really not about your innocence or guilt. And you know, this often happens in the media when we hear, you know, a famous actor or somebody talks about, engages in a racist statement or a racist behavior or some kind of, and they start, I have a black friend, I am not a racist. And before we know it, we've already got to the point where we're not even talking about the behavior. It really doesn't matter who you are, it matters what you do. One of my favorite speakers on these issues, his name is Jay Smoove. He's actually in my resource list. He has an 8-series video about systemic racism. He said, if somebody stole your wallet, you wouldn't chase after him and tell him, hey, you're a robber, you stole my wallet. You would tell him, give me my wallet back, right? And what I mean by that is like, it's not useful to try to prove that you're innocent and prove that you're an ally. It's more a matter of what you do. Another thing that I want to say is don't use allyship to enhance your personal power. I will tell you, I've been doing this work for 15 years. And since George Floyd's death, I probably get about 40 emails a day of people asking me, will you create a library for me? Will you come and give this talk to me? And it's not that I don't want to do this work, or I have people volunteering me for things without even asking me do I have the room for it and the space for it? And I'll tell you, my other peers of color and other marginalized identities, it's even tenfold for them. And so there's nothing wrong with wanting to collaborate with a person, but if you're only doing it to like make your agency look good or to, you know, check off that cultural competence bar, then that's a problem. And if you're asking people to do it for free on their own time, I heard a friend say that people treat diversity and inclusion work like the housework of professionalism. So although it's so important and so integral, especially now, but always, it's often not paid for, done on our own time. And it's often done by the people who are most impacted by it, by people of color and other marginal identities are typically the ones serving on diversity committees, making anti-racist agendas, doing anti-racist education. There's nothing wrong with that, but we need to compensate them. We need to elevate them. We need to respect them. And we need to ask them if they want to do it. Don't just assume because someone's a person of color from another marginalized identity that they want to do it. That basically goes to don't treat someone like a function, you know, just for your purposes, just to help educate you or help you feel better or help your program get better. Another thing is to interact from a place of equity and collaboration. Another thing that can get in the way of this is urgency. This is actually part of white culture, and I will say actually white supremacy culture, is that when we see a problem, we want to fix it. We want to understand it and get rid of it. Right? You know, this came up with after George Floyd's death, you know, like Nike's putting up Black Lives Matter on their, you know, Panera Bread and all these different things. But I actually heard a Black woman say, you know, that's great, but I want to see a Black CEO, you know, like, there's nothing wrong with supporting solidarity, but, you know, racism has existed as long as this country has existed and as long as this world has existed. Being so quick to try to fix it without really understanding what the problem is and involving voices of color and other marginalized groups to solve the problem in an equitable place is problematic. Promote inclusive collaboration at all levels of representation and power. And so if people of color and other marginalized groups are the only people doing the work, that's a problem. And so there needs to be white allies. There needs to be other majority culture allies, you know, like for example, I work in a hospital system. If it's just people who are not managers and not upper echelons of power trying to create these systemic changes, they fall short. And so basically all people that are part of the problem need to have a seat at the table. Another thing is, are different groups and perspectives represented in the agendas, action steps, and actions that you're taking? Are they really making a difference for the people you're trying to ally for? Expand opportunity for access for individuals and groups. You know, so when you look around your church, your hospital, your neighborhood, are there people of color in positions of power? Are the people that you live with, work with, go to school with, represented? And another thing is that action is needed at the institutional, interpersonal, and internal levels. And what I mean internal is inside the mind. Part of challenging racism is changing the way we think and changing the way we act. People with power and privilege and leadership need to be a part of the solution, but they need to do it from a place of equity. I wanna talk, before we open up the questions, a little bit about white allyship. And so bias and prejudice are not just a white person's problem, but because if you were born white in this country, you are born privileged in a way that people of color are not. There are some things that I'm just gonna shout out. One of my colleagues said, just naming the elephants in the room. So if there is an inherent power differential between whites and people of color when it comes to doing this work, there is so much more of a risk if you are a person of color speaking out, advocating, allying for, and doing this work. Just any discussion on race or racism is so much more, can be so much more dangerous both psychologically and emotionally for a person of color, and you need to remember that. Another thing is, like, white privilege is real. It's not a lie. It's impacting our world. Trying to refute it or say it doesn't matter is not helpful. And I know we, like I said, we think of white supremacy like just like, you know, like skinheads or neo-Nazis or alt-right, but white supremacy can show up in different ways that we're unaware of. And this is hard to swallow, but white people have benefited from the racist systems and the oppression that surrounds them, even if they don't believe in it, even if they think they are an anti-racist. I think that I've benefited from this system, even doing the work that I do and coming from the family that I've come from. I don't like that I have, but I have to acknowledge that it's real. Another thing, for white people, our fears of appearing racist and realizing our racism and acknowledging white privilege and white supremacy can impede honest discussions about race. Like I said, so many of us get caught up in proving our innocence, proving we're not biased, making it about ourselves, that we really lose the whole point of wanting to do this work or wanting to change. A white ally needs to acknowledge the limits of his or her or their knowledge about people's experiences, but don't use that as a reason not to think or act, you know? And so we need to always err on the side of discussion, always be humble and admit what you don't know. But that doesn't mean you shouldn't speak up, because a lot of people think, well, I don't know how to do this work. I don't know how to be an anti-racist. I don't even know what an ally is. I don't want to speak up for a person of color. And so they don't say anything. But that goes back to my statement. If you are silent or apathetic, it is interpreted as supporting racism. So that brings me to the next thing is, it needs consistent action and commitment. A white ally does not remain silent, but confronts racism as it comes up daily. So the more you do this work, the more you're going to start to see it. And the more you see it, the more you need to speak up. And what that means is that a white person seeks to deconstruct racism and oppression, both institutionally, interpersonally, and internally. So you need to start working within your systems. You need to start doing it within your personal relationships and in the life of the mind. A white ally lives in a way that challenges systemic oppression, even at the risk of experiencing some of that yourself. So speaking up means you might get some of the heat and some of the experiences that people of color face on a daily basis. But if the world is to change, we're going to have to do that. Connection, collaboration, and non-complacency. Being a white ally entails building relationships and collaborating with people of color, making sure they don't just have a seat at the table, but they're at the center. A white ally challenges other people in their thinking and actions about race. This is best done from a place of relation and compassion. So, you know, getting curious, asking people, did you hear what you just said? Like, am I taking that in? So, you know, it's best to call people in, like, try to have a dialogue, try to connect, you know, soften your start. One of my favorite things that I say comes from my psychology training, like, your impact was different from your intent. You know, like, I'll give you an example. I had a colleague who told me, why do I do this work? You know, the world sees you as white. And this is a peer who's a fellow psychologist. And what I said is, you know, I don't think you're intending to hurt my feelings, but can I tell you a little bit about the impact of that? The impact of that for me is that you're telling me that I don't know who I am and I don't know how to define myself. And because I am light-skinned, I somehow am less Latino. I don't know if that's what you meant to tell me, but that's how I took it. That's a little, I tend to be blunt, but getting curious and saying, like, is that what you meant? And most of the time they'll say they don't. Sometimes we do just have to call it out though. Like, sometimes you just gotta call a spade a spade. If somebody's saying something horrific and it's not the time to get curious, it's the time to speak up and the time to get, or somebody's doing something behaviorally atrocious, we can't be complacent. White allies don't have it all figured out, but they're deeply committed to not being complacent, to looking and seeing and educating and speaking up and acting in solidarity. So in conclusion, for just the teaching piece of this forum tonight, this is a quote that I think sums up this whole forum tonight, which is by Lila Watson. If you have come here to help me, you are wasting your time. But if you have come here because your liberation is bound up with mine, then let us work together. So with that, I think we're gonna open it up to questions. And as Amy said, we are recording, but this is where we're gonna actually end the recording. If we open up the mics, you will not be worried that your questions or your answers will be recorded. This is